Am I on? There we go. Good morning and welcome to Colonial Park United Church of Christ, where no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. We're glad that you've chosen to join us in worship, whether it be here in our sanctuary in person or online through our live streaming. Welcome. Please indicate your participation today by signing in the attendance pad at the end of your row, or through, if you're online, through our online attendance pad. We appreciate you letting us know of your time with us today. I don't have a lot of announcements, primarily because they are all in your bulletin. But the one thing I do want to highlight is this evening we are having an end of summer, if you will, a potluck and pool party over at Pastor Scott and Michael's. If you need directions for where that is, just let me know after the service. But bring your swimsuit if you are comfortable in, 80 degrees outside. I hear their pool is nice and toasty, probably above that. So feel free to come swimming. Bring a dish for others to enjoy as well. They will provide the meat, so you will have your protein provided today. Also bring a lawn chair. We will be having it, since it's not, the weather is not predicted to be an all-out deluge. We will plan on meeting over there if we end up having some of the spotty showers. We are welcomed inside their home. They do ask that if we go inside that we wear masks. So please come so that we can join. We've been trying to put together some outdoor activities that we're able to gather together in person and enjoy one another's company a little bit more. So join us tonight at 5 o'clock. All of that being said, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Thank you.
I invite you to rise as you are able in body, mind, and spirit as we join together in this morning's call to worship. If you come into this place with the hope of growing deeper and the hope of connecting and the hope of glimpsing God, and if all those things take place and your spirit is moved and you swear God is near and you feel more lucky for the gift of faith, and then the service comes to an end and it's time for you to leave and you ask yourself, where do we go from here? Then I would say to you, go into the world to love and to serve and to learn, but come back soon, because this is the beginning. This is only the beginning. So come on in, fill your cup here, be present here. God is here. Let us worship Holy God. Let us pray. God of Ruth and Naomi, of hope and bitterness, harvest and hunger, life and death, we offer our prayers of blessing on the feet and lives of women and men living in poverty and taking risks to feed their families and communities. You, Lord, are born in our resistance to injustice and shoulder with women the burden of poverty. Invite us into solidarity with them and with you as you lead us to life and justice. Amen. Let us join together in our opening hymn, Welcome Into This Place. One of the things I love about the prayer of confession is it allows us to claim that we are works in progress. And there is beauty in that. You don't have to be perfect here. You don't have to have it all figured out here. You don't have to have a five-step plan for what's next here. You just have to show up with your messy, beautiful self, and be honest. So friends, let's just be honest. Let us pray the prayer of confession together.
We are naturals when it comes to stalling out. We reach a certain point in the relationship, in the conversation, in our faith, and then we stall. We buy property on the top of the plateau and build a house there, destined to never dig deeper or climb higher. Forgive us for giving up on the things that matter. Forgive us for confusing the plateau with the mountaintop. Forgive us for taking the easy way out instead of doing the hard work of curiosity, relationship building, vulnerability, and connection. Inspire us to see new paths for where we can go from here. With hope and honesty, we pray. Amen.
Family of faith, we are works in progress, but we are works in progress designed, created, and claimed by God. No matter what you have done or left undone this week, today is a fresh start. Hear and believe the good news of the gospel.
God is with me on the mountaintop, and God is with me on the plateau. I am loved, claimed, and forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I've walked among the shadows. You wiped my tears away. I felt the pain of heartbreak. I've seen brighter days. I've prayed prayers to heaven from my lowest place. I have held your blessings, God, you give and take away. No matter what I have, your grace is enough. And no matter where I am, I'm standing in your love. On the mountains I will bow my life to the one who set me there. In the valley I will lift my eyes to the one who sees me there. But when I'm standing on the mountain, I can get there on my own. When I'm walking through the valley, I know that I am not alone. You're God of the hills and valleys, God of the eyes. Oh, 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 I am not alone.
Be seated.
Let us pray. Holy God, we know that you are always speaking through strangers and friends, through sunrises and sunset, through random acts of kindness and feelings that stir hope awaken us. We know that you speak through dreams and prayer, through a still small voice, and through bursts of overwhelming joy. We know that you're always speaking, but we also know that we are inclined to miss it. Settle our spirits now to hear your word fully. We want to be part of the conversation. Gratefully we pray. Amen.
As part of this series, I've been meaning to ask. We've been sharing in some poetry written by Reverend Sarah R. Today it's entitled Flashlight. I wish I could draw you a map of the next steps, the next conversation, the next brave truth, the next fumble, the next apology. Wouldn't it be nice to know what's coming? Wouldn't it be nice to prepare our hearts? But I don't know where to go from here. I am a child with a flashlight, deeply hopeful and a little nervous, all at the same time. What I do know is I don't want to go anywhere without you. So I'm hoping that you will take my hand, see this truth, trust my voice, look for the good, and day by day, we can go from here. Because we were never meant to go alone. And maybe we'll get lost, but then again, maybe we'll be found. So if you're willing, if you'll just say yes, I will let you hold the flashlight. We can find our way. Step by step, light in hand, abolishing shadows together. Who needs a map when you have the light anyway?
The lesson from our Hebrew scriptures today comes from the book of Ruth, chapter 1. Verses 6 through 19. Naomi and her husband Elimelech traveled from Bethlehem and settled in the land of Moab. Naomi had two sons, and when grown, they each married a Moabite woman. Unfortunately, Naomi's husband and sons died while in Moab. She planned on heading back to her home, Bethlehem. Today's translation being used is the message. Let us hear what God is saying to us, God's people. One day, Naomi got herself together, she and her two daughters-in-law, to leave the country of Moab and set out for home. She had heard that God had been pleased to visit his people and give them food. And so she started out from the place where she had been living, she and her two daughters-in-law with her, on the road back to the land of Judah. After a short while on the road, Naomi told her two daughters-in-law, "Go back. Go home and live with your mothers, and may God treat you as graciously as you treated your deceased husbands and me. May God give each of you a new home and a new husband." She kissed them, and they cried openly. They said, "No, we're going on with you to your people." But Naomi was firm. "Go back, my dear daughters. Why would you come with me? Do you suppose I still have sons in my womb who can become your future husbands? Go back, dear daughters. On your way, please. I'm too old to get a husband. Why, even if I said there's still hope and this very night got a man and had sons, can you imagine being satisfied to wait until they were grown? Would you wait that long to get married again? No, dear daughters, this is a bitter pill for me to swallow, more bitter for me than for you. God has dealt me a hard blow. Again, they cried openly. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth embraced her and held on. Naomi said, look, your sister-in-law is going back to live with her own people and God's. Go with her. But Ruth said, don't force me to leave you. Don't make me go home. Where you go, I go, and where you live, I will live. Your people are my people. Your God is my God. Where you die, I'll die, and that's where I'll be buried. So help me God. Not even death itself is going to come between us. When Naomi saw that Ruth had her heart set on going with her, she gave in. And so the two of them traveled on together to Bethlehem. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The second lesson today comes from the Acts of the Apostles, Acts chapter 10, verses 23 through 36. It is part of a larger story in Acts 10, where Peter has a vision where he is told by God to eat non-kosher food, and where a prayerful man, Cornelius, captain of the Italian guard stationed in Caesarea, was given a vision where he was told to receive Peter into his home. Listen for the still speaking words of Christ. The next morning, Peter got up and went with the men sent by Cornelius. Some of his friends from Joppa went along, and a day later they entered Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them and had his relatives and close friends waiting with him. The minute that Peter came through the door, Cornelius was up on his feet greeting him, and then down on his face worshiping him. Peter pulled him up and said, "None of that. I'm a man and only a man, no different from you." Talking things over, they went on into the house, where Cornelius introduced Peter to everyone who had come. Peter addressed them. "You know, I'm sure that this is highly irregular. Jews just don't do this, visit and relax with people of another race. But God has just shown me that no race is better than any other. So the minute I was sent for, I came, no questions asked. But now I'd like to know why you sent for me." Cornelius said, "4 days ago, at about this time, mid-afternoon, I was home praying. And suddenly there was a man right in front of me, flooding the room with light. He said, 'Cornelius, your daily prayers and neighborly acts have brought you to God's attention. I want you to send to Joppa to get Simon, the one they call Peter. He's staying with Simon the Tanner down by the sea.' So I did it. I sent for you, and you've been good enough to come. And now we're all here in God's presence, ready to listen to whatever the Master put in your heart to tell us." Peter fairly exploded with his good news. It's God's own truth. Nothing could be plainer. God plays no favorites. It makes no difference who you are or where you're from. If you want God and are ready to do as he says, the door is open. The message he sent to the children of Israel, that through Jesus Christ, everything is being put together again. Well, he's doing it everywhere and among everyone. God is still speaking. Spread the good news.
Before I offer the sermon prayer, I wanted to make one more announcement that I've been forgetting to make, and that is that choirs are beginning. And so our bell choir and our sanctuary choir are gathering together in the coming weeks. Please see Pastor Scott if you are interested in participating in either of those. We're looking for wonderful volunteers to help us continue to worship together. Let us pray. Holy God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, the Spirit in this place be pleasing and acceptable to you, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I've been meaning to ask, where do we go from here? One of the things that I've appreciated most about this series is that the scripture lessons that they choose are not singular in nature with that answer. So we have these two scripture lessons today. Where do we go from here? And one is a story that is, I don't know, I'm just putting one foot in front of the other. And the other is, oh, God told me where to go. God told me where to go. I don't know that that's always a good thing. But I like that it's not as simple as do this. It really is about listening. It's about timing. It's about asking God what it's time for. We have the story in the book of Ruth of the, if you gathered it, it's Naomi who has her husband has taken her from her people, if you will, or they've traveled together to the land of Moab. She's from Bethlehem. And her sons marry there. Marry Moabite women, you know, those women from the other side of the tracks, is probably a little bit how it was seen and how it was probably heard. Right? When the story is first told, it's a little bit like, you know, hearing that they went to Moab and the people hearing it, if you're, you know, the little Jewish children, they're going, no, don't go there. And they go, and the sons marry. Now, the sons end up dying. The husband ends up dying, and Naomi is crushed, and she is like, I can't do this. I can't stay in this land. I need to go back home to my people. She tells her daughters-in-law, you stay here. You go back to your people. I'll go back to mine. In many respects, they owe nothing to her, because what happens next is really for her sons to have had to be, for her to have other sons who would have married these women, which she doesn't. And so she's like, look, even if I magically found somebody today and I had children, are you going to wait till they're 20-something to marry them? I don't think so. So she says, go, be with your own people. And one of them listens to that. I found it interesting to choose this story because on one hand, all of this series we've been learning about listening to people, listening to what they need, listening to where it hurts. And Orpah listens to what Naomi says and goes back with her people. And Ruth says, no. You might think you know what you need, but I am in it with you. She's willing to change her faith, her religion, if she had one. Her practices, the customs, to see Naomi through. She's willing to make a commitment and a covenant with her in this bitter time in Naomi's life that says, where you go, I will go. Your people will be my people, your God, my God. She's willing to make that commitment and that vow. In another story, in our New Testament story, we again have unlikely relations. We have the story of Peter and Cornelius. Now, Cornelius is one of these centurion people working for Rome. And so again, the first response is, no. Boo, don't have anything to do with him. And then we read that he's a follower of God. He prays every day. He leads his family in God's way. In fact, God comes to him in a vision and tells him to invite Peter to his house. Peter, a man that he's basically like, this is a Jewish person who I am asked to put down. I'm asked to lord over and make follow the rules. And Peter, well, Peter, we know a lot of stories about Peter, but Peter in this story has a vision as well. And God shows up and shows this blanket full of food and all of this stuff that Peter is not supposed to eat if he's following the rules. And God says to him, eat. What? And then in the vision, Peter learns and hears that God doesn't show favorites. So Peter gets invited to Cornelius' house, and they both have had these visions from God to allow them to be in each other's company. But I have to wonder, were they afraid? How much did Peter drag his feet in going? We're told that Cornelius not only had Peter come to his house, but he invited friends. Come and hear what he has to say. Peter gets there, and all Cornelius says is, tell me what you have to say and what you've learned from God. Two very different responses to where do we go from here? Part of the challenge, I think, is that we can get focused on our own pain. A little bit like Naomi, and able to say, she actually says, call me Mara, which means bitter, for life is bitter. And sometimes we need those people who are willing to say, you're not alone in this, and we'll get through. Where do we go from here? I had to think, again, some of you know that I'm a Disney fan. In Frozen 2, there is a place, very sad place, where Anna is crying and she feels that she has lost her sister. She is at this very Naomi place and she's like, I don't know if I can go on. I don't know what to do. And she remembers being told to do the next right thing. Sometimes that's all we can do. That's where we go from here, into that next step of that next right thing. And yes, sometimes that takes discernment. Sometimes that takes a little bit extra effort. Sometimes that takes listening. Sometimes it's knowing that we are in pain, but we know we are not alone. And so we can take that step forward into hope, into possibility, into God's joy and God's grace, into life together. Where do we go from here? I have no doubt that before these visions, if Cornelius and Peter said that they were going to have this conversation together, they would have said, no way. And sometimes, many times, we're invited to set down our prejudices. God invites us, like Peter, to say, I don't show the partiality. I don't show the favoritism. So it must be you who's making that judgment. And we still have to be willing to listen to God and have those difficult conversations, have those courageous conversations. All through this series, what we've been learning is not an answer to the question that is an ending. Where do we go from here? Oh, let me tell you. But really, we've been learning and studying. Where we go from here is that we cultivate curiosity. We ask questions. We aren't afraid to take the time to listen. We have courageous conversations. We seek connection. We remember that we're all human beings. And how to care for one another. We step into this new beginning together. And I'd like to close with a word from Reverend Aisha Brooks Johnson. She writes this: we have experienced a lot of death, grief, and loss in the midst of a global pandemic, racial brokenness, economic disparity, and political division. Can you imagine a world in which we took spiritual oaths like the one we find in the book of Ruth? What if we resisted the temptation to fight or to flee in the face of grief, pain, and oppression? What if we took these vows with members of our human family? Imagine a member of the human family before you, and you speak these words aloud to them. By the mercy of God, and because of God's grace, we are bound to one another. Your pain is not your own, but is now my pain. The plight of your people is held in my hands and my heart as if they were my own. Where you journey and work, I too will journey and work alongside of you with God's help. Where your bones are buried, may I too find a resting place and declare every earthly resting place sacred in the eyes of God. Imagine standing in front of someone, and I'd like to add, especially someone not quite like you, the least likely person, and being able to say that. Imagine hearing that from someone, and know that I say it to you. Amen. Where do we go from here? It's not an ending, it's a beginning. And so it seems appropriate that today we get to celebrate that beginning with the receiving of new members. Friends in Christ, we all are received into the church through the sacrament of baptism. Oh, let me invite you forward first, actually. I don't think that's actually in my script. So I'd like to invite forward Theo, Rudy, Joyce, Covey, Connie, Herman, and Rob Herman, Jr. Rob, there is a chair up here if that's helpful to you. Connie, why don't you stand next to Rob so that he can see off of your paper? Let me try this again. Friends in Christ, we are all received into the church through the sacrament of baptism. Joyce, Theo, Connie, and Rob found nurture and support in the midst of the family of Christ. Through prayer and study, they have been led by the Holy Spirit to affirm their baptism and to claim in our presence their covenantal relationship with Christ and the members of the church. They are here for the service, for service to Jesus Christ, using the gifts which the Holy Spirit bestows. We are the body of Christ, which means we are a part of a covenant that God has made with us. God's covenant is everlasting, for God is always faithful. We are asked to do our part and to love God back, to love God with our whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. We do this best in relationship within a community.
Vine, you are the branches. Anyone who abides in me and I in that person is the one who bears much fruit. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you will, and it shall be done for you. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full.
Joyce, Theo, Connie, and Rob, do you desire to affirm your baptism into the faith and family of Jesus Christ?
I do.
God has made it plain through Jesus Christ that God loves you unconditionally. Do you confess your faith in Jesus Christ and take for your style of life his words, "You shall love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself"? Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow in the Christian faith and to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission in all the world?
I promise with the help of God.
I invite those of you who are able to stand and join together as we affirm our faith.
Here in the body of Christ, this congregation, we live out our faith. We rejoice in our diversity and celebrate that which we hold in unity. Please join us as we unite with the church in all times and places, affirming our faith in the triune God. Do you believe in God?
I believe in God.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit.
You may be seated. By your baptism, you were made one with us and in the body of Christ, the Church. Today, we rejoice in your pilgrimage of faith, which has brought you to this time and this place. We give thanks for every community of faith that has been your spiritual home, and we celebrate your presence in this household of faith. Do you promise to participate in the life and mission of this family of God's people, sharing regularly in the worship of God and enlisting in the work of this local church as it serves this community and the world?
I promise with the help of God.
Do you, who witnessed this covenant today, promise your love, support, and care to the ones affirming their baptism as they live and grow in Christ?
We promise our love, support, and care.
Will you try to make God's freeing love concrete and real for these special people who are entrusting this family of God, their faith and fears, their hopes and regrets, their strengths and their weaknesses?
Yes, we will.
As we, the body of Christ, are ready and eager to surround you with our love and care, you, as a new disciple, are joining this family, which is a divine gift to you. In the presence of these friends, even virtually, do you promise that so far as you are able, you will attend the services of this church, celebrate its sacraments, shoulder its work, support its benevolence, and further Christ's mission in all the world?
Yes, I promise with the help of God.
O God, we praise you for calling us to faith and for gathering us into the church as the body of Christ. We thank you for your people gathered in this local church and rejoice that you have increased our community of faith. Together may we live in the Spirit, building one another up in love, sharing in the life and worship of the church, and serving the world for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen.
So let us, the disciples of Colonial Park United Church of Christ, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry in Christ.
We promise you our continuing friendship and prayers
as we share the hopes and labors of
the Church of Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we continue to grow together in God's knowledge and love and be witnesses of our risen Savior.
As Christ welcomed all who came to him,
regardless of social status, wealth, family,
ethnicity, race, gender,
holiness, righteousness, purity,
illness, disabilities, limitations,
intelligence, mental health, abilities,
religion, faith, or commitment.
So do we welcome all who come, all who are sent, all who join us, for God has called us all to be one family in Christ. Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ and on behalf of the congregation of Colonial Park United Church of Christ, I extend to you the right hand of fellowship, or the elbow bump, as the case may be in this time and place, of Christian love. Welcome into the family. I have some things for you. Don't go too far. I left them up front. So welcome, welcome. I'm going to invite you, if you are able, to join us in the back flip with Joyce. Thank you. At the end of the service, if you can join me in the back for receiving people, if you're comfortable with that. Otherwise, down at Fellowship Hall during fellowship. So, friends, let us one more time welcome our new members of our family. As you are able, as we join in body, mind, and spirit in our call, in our hymn, called as partners in Christ's service. It's found in your hymnal, hymn number 495, verses 1 and 2. seated. Friends, a reminder that we are a praying community, and we want to be with you on this journey, so please take a moment and fill out in the pew in front of you. There should be some blue prayer cards. Share your prayers, your concerns, your joys and celebrations, and then you are invited to bring those forward at the time of offering and place them into the offering plate. If you are worshiping with us online, please feel free to use our online prayer request form. These prayers then are shared with our prayer team and our prayer chain and are prayed over for the week and following. Let us pray. God of conversation, we are here. We are trying. And I know there are times that you go, yes, you are very trying. But we are trying to be courageous. We are trying to be curious. We are trying to build connections in this lonely and isolated world. And sometimes we want to be somewhere other than here. We want to be standing in a place and a time that is closer to your promised day, where all are fed, the prisoners are freed, the homeless are housed, and every person knows their worth. And we know we can't get there without honest and vulnerable conversation, but we don't always know what to ask. We fear saying the wrong thing. We fear offending, and so we eat our words and we stay quiet, hoping that answers will come, but they don't always come. Connection has never been quite so easy for us. So today we ask for your words. Plant questions in us like seeds. Grow into a garden of connection. Plant affirmation in us that, like laughter, is contagious and mood-changing. Plant curiosity in us that, like rain, washes away any judgment we carry, replacing it with a desire to understand. And when we have your words in our mouths and your mind in our hearts, then teach us how to listen. Teach us how to hear the message under the words, the grief, the hurt, the fear, the shame that hangs under sentences like bats under a bridge. Help us to hear and make space for those unspoken truths. And then teach us how to listen to voices that differ from us, voices with different opinions, with different histories, with different perspectives, so that like Ruth and Naomi, like Peter and Cornelius, we might move through disagreement and ultimately find you. God of conversation, we are here. Trying to be courageous. We are here trying to be curious. We are here trying to build connections. It's easier said than done, and we need you like we need this community, like we need the sunrise every morning. So draw near to us. Teach us how to speak. Teach us how to listen. And teach us how to find you in the spaces between our words and our ears. And as you do, hear and receive these prayers. God of conversation, we've been meaning to ask, where do we go from here? How do we speak truth? How do we listen for you? Guide us, be with us, hold us, unsettle us, catch us, feed us, fill us, meet us here, God. We are open. Pour your very self into us. Gratefully we pray. Amen. And hear us now, O God, as we share in our Lord's Prayer, using words most familiar to us. Our Father, Mother in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The story of Ruth and Naomi is a story of God working through people. Naomi needed Ruth to make it back home and start fresh, just as Peter needed Cornelius to understand God's message. Mary needed Elizabeth. Jesus needed the disciples. And Moses needed Aaron. The story of our faith is one that constantly reminds us that we cannot do this work alone. So, in community, we ask ourselves, where do we go from here? And one answer to that question is that we can give what we can from what we have and trust that God will continue moving us closer to that promised day. So, family of faith, I invite you to give your tithes and your offerings now, knowing that this is the work of community. This is the work of faith. Let us give.
Thank you.
let us join together in our prayer of dedication. May the offerings brought this day be used as seeds planted faithfully and nurtured lovingly, so that God's way may be realized anew in this world. Grant us the humility we need to plant and then tend your precious garden. Amen. Friends, as we get ready to join together in our ascending hymn, Lead Me, Guide Me, I ask Sharon to go to the back with our new disciples to give them time to journey back the aisle before the benediction. So just so you know, and those new disciples, those joined today, if you can make your way to the back, that'd be great. Friends, just an additional reminder that you are invited to our fellowship time in our fellowship hall immediately following the service. And then I hope to see as many of you as possible this evening at 5 o'clock at Pastor Scott and Michael's for a potluck and pool party. Family of faith, as you leave this place, may God grant you the curiosity to counter assumptions, the vulnerability to befriend, the bravery to speak your truth, the wisdom to listen, the strength to ask for help, the resiliency to choose love even when it's hard, and the awareness of the Holy Spirit always beside you. In the name of the great connector, love itself, go in peace. Amen.